Sorry, we're late. I was waiting to hear Meryl's entrance French horns that usually go along with the announcement of her name.
Yes.
Welcome, one and all. Stephen, I'm going to start with you. Many films take many years to come to fruition, yeah. And others fall into place much more quickly. Can you tell us which category The Post falls into?
Oh, there's only one category The Post falls into, which is like instantaneously. You know, a lot of my movies take a long time to develop. I buy books. I develop scripts. Years go by. I make other movies instead. It percolates. It comes back into my life. You know, I finally get around to making them. And this was in my entire, I guess, span of 49 years professionally directing. I've never had a film come together this quickly.
So the reason for that urgency in that case, can I ask, I mean, had a certain presidential election back in 2016 gone in a different direction, would there still have been that impetus?
Yes.
Film? Or, I mean, are the issues bigger than one president?
I think the issues are much bigger than one administration. Had the election gone a different way, I would have still found a real urgency to tell the story, because the first thing that attracted me to The Post was Katharine Graham, was her story, was her evolution as a real person of real potential power that did not really have the facility to exercise that power because she hadn't quite found her center of gravity. She hadn't been able to find how to use her own voice. And that is part of her autobiography, My Story. That is something that's been written about and talked about. I knew that about Katharine Graham, and so before the obvious comparisons between 2017 and 2071, I mean 1971, before all of those, it was the Katharine Graham story, and then eventually the Ben Bradlee Katharine Graham relationship that would have made a good movie, whether it had been in the last election cycle, had that gone differently, or at any time.
Well, I wanted to bring you in at that point as well. I mean, it's an astonishing performance as Katharine Graham. I wonder, when you were coming to the story, how much the attraction was to the whole story and how much to the chance to spotlight Katharine Graham, who was obviously this figure who perhaps hadn't had the spotlight in the past, where she should have done.
Well, I thought what was interesting about the screenplay was that it fell to a woman to hold the line for press freedom at a time when women were excluded from any kind of leadership role in the press. There were no women reporters. That was very unusual. Our friend Nora Ephron, to whom this film is dedicated, graduated from Wellesley, ran the paper there, went to Newsweek to interview, to be a reporter. At that time, Katharine Graham owned Newsweek. And the interviewer told her she was very welcome. She was a brilliant woman. She's very welcome to be a researcher, a copy girl, or a secretary. But reporters were men. I look around this room, and I see many, many women. And you would not be here in 1971. So it was a different world. And so for this crucial, crucial decision to hold the line and to risk everything, to have that fall to a woman who was really alone in her position, that's what interested me. Both, sure. Holding the line for press freedom and the fact that it was a transitional moment for women.
I mean, The Post is a film, obviously, with your extraordinary performance at the center, but also pivotal roles for women behind the camera as well. You know, mentioned the screenplay, which is co-written by Liz Hannah. Amy Pascal here as co-producer. I'm going to ask you, Meryl, first, but I'd be interested in Tom and Stephen, in your takes on this as well, whether you think we've reached a stage in the film industry where it's telling stories about women is a wonderful thing, but also there have to be stories being told by women. Meryl.
Yes, I think it's important that the stories be about women, that there be, you know, parity, equal. Half the world is female, half the world is male. We have different tastes, we have different interests. Sometimes they dovetail, sometimes they don't. It just seems like the predominance of the offerings from Hollywood have been usually, and around the world, have been stories driven by men. That's great. Many of the films have been fantastic. But yes, they should be made by women, mostly they should be greenlit by women. I think if women were equally represented in the agencies, at the heads of studios, on the corporate boards that own the studios, the world would be a different place.
There's many, many more women directors, not enough of them, but many, many more telling significant stories and making a real place for themselves. Handmaid's Tale is one such example. So is the film Mudbound, Lady Bird, Wonder Woman. You know, there is a new kind of story that is being told that may not be. There was a time also where a lot more women ran the green light system at different studios. Stacey Snyder at Universal, and now at Fox.
Bankrolled our film.
Bankrolled our film. Sherry Lansing, many years, was the final word at Paramount Pictures. I mean, this is not revisionist history. This is just the ebb and flow, the sine wave of women's involvement at the highest levels. And then when there was a dearth of women at the highest levels. In 1971, when the story was told, there were no women CEOs of any Fortune 500 companies until Katharine Graham. She was the first one.
Can you feel the industry changing in maybe more of an enduring way? I mean, Stephen mentioned ebbs and flows just then. But maybe next time, do you think, as women enter the industry, this time that they will be here to stay?
Well, I think you have to divide the industry into two different distinct conferences or, you know, categories. Television kicks movies' ass when it comes down to diversity in the workplace, both by way of skin color, racial background, as well as the number of women that work in it. In television, and which is probably better than it has ever been because of the advent of, the 10-part series, the ongoing almost novels that play themselves out. Women are much better represented in that medium than they are in motion pictures. The economics of movies, I think, have been determined by the men who make the decisions, who think that, well, we need to have, you know, essentially boys and guys and dads decide who's going to go off and pay the $20 per ticket. I've worked with women more often than I've worked with a lot of Penny Marshall. I made multiple movies with her. There was never any question of who was the boss on that film. Nora Ephron, and my family's worked with her three or four times. No question of who's the boss there. I've worked with women executives and women screenwriters on down the pike. But I'm of a certain generation that, quite frankly, didn't give too much of a shit of the gender, pardon my language, of who was in charge. The person in charge is the person in charge. What is going to come about, I think, because of this great Rubicon that has been crossed, is in those boardrooms and in that decision-making process and in the people who sign checks, it's not just the financial, it's also the storytelling artistic aspect of it, you are going to see a different proportion between then and now. I think more women are going to be awarded their positions based on the merits, the quality of their work. And for a while, why not just make it literally make it specific. Let's make it, there's no reason not for a while to say, we need more women on this board, we need more women running these departments, we need more women in our company and in the decision-making process, so it actually represents the numbers as they truly are in our society.
One of the other striking things about The Post is it's a film that feels like it has a huge affinity for journalism. And filmmakers and journalists aren't always on the same side of things. But I wanted to get all of your takes
proves.
Well, it's a room full of journalists. You're very much among friends. I mean, do you feel an affinity with journalism, I suppose, at any point, but maybe particularly at this moment in time? Meryl?
Sorry, I couldn't hear the first part.
I wondered whether you felt an affinity with journalism.
It was in my mind.
It's often the problem. The Post feels like a film which is very sympathetic to and has a huge affinity with journalism.
Yeah.
And I wondered whether you feel that personally, whether you feel that specifically personally now, because obviously the press and the film industry are both under pressures, and there's pressures from the same direction. And so do you feel yourself among friends as you sit here in a room full of journalists?
Well, I don't know. I hope I'm among friends. I certainly have been supportive of the committee to protect journalists. I think that those, the organizations that do specifically protect journalists whose lives are in danger, is really important. But supporting journalists, all of whom are, in my opinion, underpaid for the service they do to certainly our nation, yeah, we all have to support them and to call out the attempts by powerful interests to control their work and to delegitimize the institutions that give them work and that support them. So, yeah, I feel that more than ever right now.
Tom, I mean, Ben Bradlee is obviously this deeply iconic figure for all journalists. In playing him, did you kind of uncover a new sympathy and understanding for journalists, or was that already there with you?
Well, I think that there, on two phases, you're talking about the press as the institution, as the estate that is required to exist in order for a free democratic republic to be a free democratic republic. Then you come down to the individuals who are inside that estate. And Ben Bradlee was a man who loved his job. It's a great job. You see the world, you get an expense account, you get to stay up late, you get to have two Dubonnets at lunch every time. That's a good gig that you can have. But the requirement...
You didn't really do that.
I did not drink Dubonnets at lunch. But let's all have a couple now, shall we? We're all amongst friends. Let's all enjoy it. It comes down to then the practitioners and the participants in that estate. Ben Bradlee, I'd say, would say things to like, well, you've got a story, but you don't have the story. Come back to me when you've got the story, meaning that let's aim at the confirmable, almost empirical truth, because you cannot suffer by printing by going out and printing the truth. And that kind of like that code of ethics, that ethos, that discipline, that desire in itself does come down to be an individual mandate that only the practitioner themselves can do. Rather than asking, how can I promote fear? How can I promote outrage? Where is the the xenophobia that we can comment on? But what's going to be the interesting story? Or the what is going to be the attractive story is a different question from what is the true story. And he was always after the latter.
As a filmmaker and personally, this is obviously for filmmakers and journalists and people at large an interesting time. Is The Post an optimistic film, or do you personally feel optimistic at the moment?
The Post is a very optimistic picture because the outcome determined the future of the Washington Post. The outcome of this story allowed Ben Bradlee and Catherine Graham to pursue, through the genius investigative reporting of Carl Bernstein and Bob Woodward, the money trail that eventually led to Richard Nixon's resignation. So that's why the film has the coda. That's why the film has that little bit of a visual epilogue projecting 2 years into the future, because one did lead to the other, and without the courage of Bradlee and Graham, there would not have been enough cojones combined with women's intuition to allow the Washington Post to go after Richard Nixon the way it did. Mm-hmm. So we really feel more than being able to minimalize our story as simply a prequel to All the President's Men. This is what allowed All the President's Men to become made as a movie.
Films, of course, can be great instruments of social change. This is a question for Meryl in particular. What about political change? We've been hearing about the pivotal role of women. Do you think Oprah should run for president?
Boy, what a build-up to a simple question. Use a bigger shovel next
it's
time.
It's my moment.
I don't think
I'm
there was enough
it.
Baloney on that in order to get around to the question.
That's funny.
Well, I think Oprah showed what a presidential candidate should talk like and to what language and passion and principle they should adhere, to what rhetoric can rouse people, and how important it is to people to feel that and to get that encouragement. That's the voice of a leader, whether she's leading us to the candidate we need or whether she herself is a candidate. She sets the bar pretty high on campaign talk.
That sounds like a yes.
I think we can take that as a yes.
I wondered what's next for the Time's Up initiative and whether you intended to continue the black dress protest at the BAFTAs and the Oscars or if there's something else on the horizon.
Well, sadly, we haven't been invited to the BAFTAs. But so I can't talk to that. But I think the Time's Up movement, the Me Too, Time's Up, this global sort of seismic change that's happening, somebody said it's like an airplane being put together while we're going down the runway to take off, you know. And so it's a little potchkied, to use the technical term. And I think we, as a movement, it's pretty interesting to be involved because there isn't a leadership hierarchy. We don't know who the top dog is. We don't know. We have a hive. It's like a hive of bees. There are more and more coming in. Everybody's making honey. Everybody's doing the good work. But it's sort of a moving thing right now. And that's good because it needs to fly. This little it needs to light on many different industries, on many different enterprises, government, military, the church. The inequities and the imbalance in power isn't just in Hollywood. The exploitation of women, their labor, and there's the exploitation of their reticence to come forward. That goes right through societies, not just in the United States. So it's a growing thing, and the most heartening thing about it to me is that it doesn't feel like a one-off. Hasn't gone away. And I don't think it will. I don't think we'll go backwards.
On the same subject, I wondered what you thought of some of the French reaction and Catherine Deneuve saying that men should have the right to bother women, you know, to hit on women awkwardly. I mean, there were
to bother them?
Yeah.
Does that have another meaning in
English?
English?
I think they said
bother means annoy?
Hit on.
Or
hit on.
Hit on. Oh, I see. Okay. I didn't know that's what. Stop bothering me. Does that mean stop hitting on me? Is that. Okay. I don't know. This letter, no, I don't. I haven't perused the letter. I heard about it and I saw Catherine Deneuve's picture on the news, but she didn't write the letter, did she? Or did she?
She signed it.
She signed it. And she's sort of the most famous person, so that's why her face is attached. I see. I better talk about this when I know what I'm talking about. Yeah.
We're out of time, I'm afraid. We're going to have to leave it there, but please join me in thanking Meryl Streep, Tom Hanks, and Steven Spielberg.
Too bad.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, our good friends.